How many of you have had a paranormal experience in your life? By a show of hands. I mean, no one's going to judge you if you were to raise your hands. Okay, I see one hand raised there. Everyone's going to come and ask you what the experience was after the session.
Especially me, I might write a book on your experience.
So I think I'm going to start with, do you believe in the paranormal? That's going to be my first question to you.
So let me tell you that I come from a science background. So it is, but horror has always fascinated me. So when it comes to the paranormal, I am quite ambivalent. Like, I do not either go all out and say that, okay, yes, this happens, there were ghosts, there were spirits, or nor do I say that, okay, this is not there at all. So far I believe that this is an unknown area which needs a lot of exploration. It's an unknown area, a lot of investigation is still to be done, and till the time we do not know how it is and what it is, let us reserve judgments on it. So the books that we are writing, that you, we are doing together, that is also trying to open the lid on certain such paranormal incidents that are happening around us, and let's see how it goes. So my answer to whether I believe in the paranormal or not is that I keep my eyes open, like I believe all of us should, neither deny nor accept, and unless and until we know more about it, let us not go one way or the other.
So I'll give you a bit of a background to our collaboration together. So I'm an editor with Penguin Books, as you heard in my introduction. And where he's written a book that's going to come out on Halloween. We had to time it with Halloween.
The mic.
It's called Haunted. And it's basically his collaboration with a paranormal investigator, Jay Alani. And both of them are writing about 10 of the spookiest places in India. There were lots that they visited, that he visited, about 100. And they shortlisted about 10. So I think another question would be, why the 10? What made you choose the 10?
So India, as you know, we are a very huge country, and there were so many remote places. Let's not talk about the urban places for the moment, because when we talk about we being urban people, we tend to think more about that. But there were so many remote places where there were so many events happening almost every day, paranormal events. And we have, if you see the list of the most haunted places in the world, if you see the top 10 or something, then out of that, I'm very sure that 2 or 3 will be from India itself. Almost all of us have heard about Kuldhara, the village that was completely abandoned overnight. People just walked away out of that village 175 years ago. And since then, the village has been in ruin. Nobody goes there. It has a very haunted kind of reputation. There is another fort which is known as Bhangad. That is more famous because a movie was made on it. So Bhangad fort actually exists, and this fort was believed to be cursed. So these are the kinds of places which have a lore, a legend of their own. Now these are hundreds of years ago, that whatever must have happened there, it is not recorded in any historical book or anything. It is just passed on from one person to the other. What is happening today is that there were a slew of paranormal investigators. Today paranormal investigation has become a kind of new passion. So everybody and even anybody is trying to know more about it. And some of the more intrepid ones are actually going and trying to look at these places. So we had a very famous paranormal investigator in India a few years ago, Gaurav Tiwari. You must have heard of him. He was quite famous. He went and investigated all these places, and he also met an untimely death. He was just 31 or 32, and he went to a place, a haunted location. When he came back, so you know, certain things happened to him there. So this is it. Today we have more paranormal investigators. Gaurav Tiwari has started a kind of trend, and one of the most famous ones today is Jay Alani. He is the guy with whom I have co-authored on this book Haunted. So Jay has been to around 120 locations, haunted locations of India. So he does research on them. He tries to find out which are the haunted locations, and he spends nights there alone with his equipment, and his equipment will be mostly the temperature thermometer that they have. There is something known as a K2 meter that captures electromagnetic frequencies. So he goes with these instruments, he stays there the whole night, and these places I am talking about, they are in the total jungle and areas like that. Nobody is allowed to enter. He sits there alone. I would not dare to do that. He does it. And then he comes back with a report of what all he saw. And in some of these places, he has, some of them were damn squibs, nothing happened. But in some of these places, he has actually come across certain things. And those were the 10 that we have taken, selected and made, put into this collection known as Haunted. So out of those, we have Kuldhara, Bhangad, and we have a Missouri forest in which, I will not give any spoilers, but you know, there is a forest in Missouri that is reputed to be haunted. Nobody ventures there, but he spent a night in that forest. So, and his own childhood experience, which started him off on this, which was a story in a hostel. So in a hostel, how he had this experience, because you know, I think for every vocation, there needs to be a calling. So his calling came when he was just 8 to 9 years old. He actually had an experience which set him on his path. So it was very interesting and fun writing the whole thing.
He actually does have a session with Jay tomorrow that you should not miss. Jay is going to be here and they're going to talk about their experience together of writing the book. But you've also written a lot in the horror genre. There's not a lot of people who choose this genre. Why? How did this, what piqued your interest in this genre firstly? Why? So
the thing is there, my, I don't know how, but my father was a kind of, you know, book collector. He was, he used to buy every book that caught his fancy, each and every book. We had a room full of books. In fact, when we were moving house, we needed a truck only to transport the books. And even then we left half of them behind. So he had all these collections. He never read even, I think, 10% of them, but he just collected. And in the afternoons, I used to be alone at home. So I used to go through his collection, climb on a ladder and take out the books that were kept on the topmost shelves. And those books were mostly the horror books. So when I was just about 13 or something, I started reading books like Dracula and Frankenstein and all from my dad's collection. And the other thing that veered me onto this was my dad was also a subtitlist. There was this profession in those days in the 90s. He used to translate movies from Hindi to English. The movie scripts would come to us. And we used to type the dialogues in Hindi on one side and typewriter, okay, on a typewriter with carbon paper and all that, and English on the other side. So his biggest clients were the Ramses. So all the Ramses movies used to come home and we had to type them off. Usually dad also had a regular job. This was not a regular job. He had a regular job. So to meet deadlines, I used to do the subtitling when I was in 7th standard. So I have translated movies like Dark Bangla, Veerana and all when I was in the 7th standard, and this helped me also to learn the structure of movie making and all. Maybe I'll use it someday, I don't know. So maybe these are the various things that precipitated me or gravitated me towards this horror genre. And I always had this propensity to write horror. The other kinds of movies didn't interest me. Romance, this didn't interest me. It was always the dark side.
So horror is a bigger category and there are a lot of sub-genres under it. Do you want to take us through the sub-genres under horror? There are all kinds that you can write in.
I could tell you about the work that I have done, because I have, paranormal is just one aspect of horror, and it is just one of my books right now, Haunted, that I have written, which is paranormal. But my other books have been on other horror sub-genres. Like my first book, Maya's New Husband, which was just mentioned, that book was a psychological thriller. It was about a woman who marries a person who turns out to be a serial killer. So it is the equation between the two of them as it works out. And it has this very supernatural element of the Aghoris also built into the genre, into the story. Another book of mine, which is also releasing, it has just released a few days back, that is Yakshini, that is with Rupa Publications. So that is a supernatural story. You know that in India we have lot of these demigods and beings, mythical, mythological beings that are never tapped. Even in our stories, in our epics also, there were many I would say beings which would lend very well to horror. If we were a Western country, we would have made horror films out of all of them. But we being Indians, we are reserved. We don't do that so much. So what I am trying to do is, I am trying to take these interesting beings from our myths, from our legends, from our lores, and trying to give them a contemporary twist. So that is what I have done in Yakshini. It is the story of a Yakshini who is a demigod who can give you blessings or who can curse you depending on which way her mind works. And she is born in our aaj ka zamana. So that is the story which was which is doing the rounds right now. A little before this, I would Pishach, which was also a supernatural story about. I think you are aware of the beings known as the Pishach. They are the blood sucking demons. They are also in our mythology. So this is supernatural horror. There is psychological horror, which Maya did. Then I am dabbling in a very new genre right now. It's a book that is still being worked on. That is Sapna's Bad Connection. That is a digital horror. So that is a new space. And I really love that story. But it's digital. So, you know, somebody stalking you over your mobile phone and over your chat messages. So that's a kind of story. And I'm also going very classic with my next one and doing a reincarnation horror. So these are various genres that Indians know and like.
So coming back to Maya's new husband, mm-hmm. I don't think a lot of people know that it's actually based on a true story, mm-hmm. A true incident. Do you want to elaborate on that a little, if you're allowed to?
Maya's new husband is, as I told you, it's a story about a woman married to a husband who turns out, a man who turns out to be a serial killer, and how she finds out, how she tries to, wrangle her way out of him. Because he is very possessive of her. So this is the grain of the story came to me as a fiction. It was not based on a real incident. But what I wove into it, the various elements that I wove into it, were from several stories that I've heard from people. Like there is this strong Aghori element. So I actually met various people. I didn't meet Aghoris, but I met people who have had first-hand encounters or experiences with the Aghoris, and I tried to put the elements of those stories into them. So I spoke to about 50 to 60 people, and I found out, and the book was, it had a lot of research, and all of that I put together, and I had this human story of the marriage, and in that I interspersed all the anecdotes that I had gathered along the way. So that is how it came about.
What kind of response do you get to that book?
Like to Maya's new husband, both. It is like equally awesome as well as equally shit. I mean, totally, ultimately. I get all kinds of. There are 1-star reviews as well as 5-star.
Paranormal is that kind of a genre. It can divide the audience because some of us believe it does. Some of us don't.
So as a horror author, you will never get complete 5-star reviews all through the way. That's never gonna happen because there were a lot of people who are very skeptical to the genre. They have a kind of bias, like because this is horror, and that may be because of how our movie industry developed in the 70s, in the 80s and the 90s, because that time horror was very kitschy. And we had, you know, horror was mixed with several other elements. There was erotica in horror, okay? Vikram Bhatt, the person who spoiled the name of horror for this generation. So what we had with horror was not actually the scare, the fear. We were not exploring fear in horror. So that was the big problem that we had. Horror should be about fear. But instead what was happening was horror had songs and horror had... So that diluted it. So
internationally, if you look, there are big horror authors who are churning out books by the dozen. You have Stephen King, but we don't have that kind of authors in India. Why do you think that is? Do we
I
not
think
there is an appetite for it, but
And the response again ties in with what I just said, because horror has got such a reputation that people today are taking horror as a kind of taboo. I think I don't know many people who would read horror, even those who like horror, to go and openly talk about it, that I read a horror book. People won't do that. But if they are reading some classic, they will go and put it all over on social media. But people who read horror, they do not usually do a propaganda of it, or they publicize it. Maybe that is one reason. But we have dedicated readers, which I can see on my own timeline and, you know, through the sales that I get.
So who did you grow up reading?
I grew up reading the classic goth horror. And apart from the horror, I read a lot of Jeffrey Archer is, of course, a very big favorite of mine. I draw a lot of inspiration from his style of writing, though he's, of course, not horror, but that is the kind of thing. And I grew up on Agatha Christie. I have devoured all her books and such people. But for horror, I took to reading Stephen King quite late. That was, I was probably just about 10, 20 years ago, because Stephen King was not so popular in India at that time, even though his movies were. So Stephen King came into my life quite late. But today I have good respect for him because he has, brought that name for the genre all over the world. And he is the best-selling author and he writes horror. So of course there is nothing to be not proud of.
So coming back to unsolved investigations, there is a book that is in progress that you're working on, that is very hush hush at the minute, but do you want to tell them about it a little? It's very gory, the case, and I'm sure a lot of you have heard of it, but it'll be nice to hear about it from you.
This ties on completely with what we are talking about, that is unsolved mysteries. So I think most of you might be aware of the Delhi mass suicide case where 11 people died in a house. So there is no explanation to why they did that. So, and it is the way that we are investigating the case. Again, this is also in collaboration with Jay. So the way that we are investigating the case is that we have found the records and stuff of what happened in the house, in the also to in the prelude to the case and also in the aftermath of it. So there was there were things like, you know, just few days ago they had a wedding in the house. And
what happened?
I would not be able to reveal that, because that is, you know, what we are also working on at the moment. But I would just say that there is probably a hand of the supernatural, which we have never been able to solve. The police has just closed the case as suicide. But there were so many elements that point to the fact that it may not be suicide. Like, there is all the 11 people were found hanging. Now, to do that, why would 11 people listen to somebody and do that en masse? We are not going to do that. And those people were not like rural people. They were from a metro. They were from Delhi. And they went to colleges. And the youngest there is 14-year-old. So she is a college-going girl. So obviously a college-going girl will not go into that, you know, blind faith and whatever that the family, we suppose, was believing in. So there might be a very different angle to it than what appears. There were certain physical clues as well, as in the house where they were found dead, there were 11 pipes made in the walls. And these 11 pipes, there is no reason for these pipes, why they were made. So, and they are all very incongruously placed. There is another clue, or whatever you say, that the evening before they committed the suicides, that evening they ordered chapatis and stuff from a nearby shop. Now, if you are going to die, why would you do that? Unless you believe you are going on a journey. You know, so there were so many aspects. It's a very fascinating case. The deeper I go into it, there were more and more layers coming out. There was an animal in the house, a dog, and that dog was missing after that day. So we don't know where the dog went and what happened to him, but there was this howling throughout the night that was heard. So, of course, I am still on the process of investigating through the records and all that we have, the official records. So, probably we'll work something out on it and solve at least this case, whatever we know out of it.
So, what is Jay's role in this as a paranormal investigator?
Jay has investigated the house. So, after the deaths occurred and the bodies were moved and all, so Jay went to the house and Jay spoke to the survivors, who does not wish to be named. And Jay got access to all the rooms of the house. He went there with his equipments and he tried to find out if something was. So what he found out is the subject matter of the book in the most part.
So everything is basically hinting at occult practices, right?
Everything is basically hinting at that. Yes.
So when you do cover something that happened for real, what do you have to be mindful of as an author? Because the case is sub judice, right?
We have to be very sensitive first and foremost, because you are writing about people who are actually living. So this is the case with every non-fiction, whether it is horror or whatever zone you are writing in. You cannot fictionalize it. And if you at all want to fictionalize it, there is a particular limit, you know, like you cannot cross. I would say that there is nothing in this world that is totally non-fiction. Any work that is reported by somebody will always have an element of their own mindset into it. So obviously there is nothing which is pure non-fiction. But even then, you need to make sure that you are not going crossing a particular line. The second thing is that it is not sub judice anymore. The case has been closed. So that is why we took it up and we were able to take it up. So that is the other element. We would not go to a case which is sub judice.
And what other works are you working on besides this? Is there anything else that you're...
I'm writing two more paranormal books. And those are with another paranormal investigator. But this time I am not going for this haunted locations. This time I am going to talk about phenomena. Now there are many paranormal phenomena that we all probably have had at some time or the other. We might have heard of sleep paralysis. So I myself was a sufferer of that for the longest time. So sleep paralysis, then there were something, you know, there were out of body experiences, and there is a near death experiences. So I'm writing a book with another paranormal investigator, Saibhijit Mohanty. He's also the world's youngest demonologist. And he is also, he's an Odia guy, he had a show and all. So with him, I'm working on a book which will tackle 10 or 12, whatever we decide, of these phenomena, along with his real life experiences that he has encountered in his journey. So that is another non-fiction, that is what I'm working on.
Coming back to Haunted, your book that's still not hit the stores, it's going to be out during Halloween. There's one chapter, I don't know if you, a lot of you know, there is a ghost fair that is held in Bihar, in Patna in Bihar, where
Sonpur,
where ghosts are bought and sold. And when I read about that, it was unbelievable at first, but it does happen for real.
Mm.
Do you want to tell us a little bit about that?
So there is
that was absolutely fascinating.
It was fascinating to me also when I heard about it. Then I did some research on it. So there is this carnival of sorts where people sit, and these people have all these supernatural occult people, the tantrics, the babas, the ojhas. So they all sit. It is just like a fair. So they sit, and there were, the customers are people who are either possessed or they want some ichha or something like that. So they come and they sit, and these babas do their jharpunk or whatever it is that they do, and these people keep on moving. It's like bargain shopping, you know, like either 50 rupees mein bhoot niklega, udhar 60 rupees mein niklega, either 20 rupees mein niklega. So that is the kind of thing that goes on there. But parts of it are really hair raising also, because that I will not speak about here, but read the book for that. So this is what is, it is on the face, and this happens in conjunction with the cattle fair. The cattle fair is very famous. We know the Sonpur cattle fair. People come from all over the world for that. So this is the hidden part of it, which happens at night.
So we're very short of time here. I don't think we have time to ask questions also. Can we take, anyone has a question?
Thank you for the very well attended session, but everybody sat like good students. I was a teacher, so that's that coming out.
Neil, so what happens when a man dies, as per you?
I have not died, so but I do believe that something should happen. See, I believe in the theory that we do have souls. All of us believe in souls. I don't think anybody, even a rationalist, would never say that we don't have souls. There is something that drives us, and that is the energy which is within us. We are not just mass. We cannot be just mass. We are mass and energy. So when we die, it is the corporeal form that goes away. But what happens to the energy? And I'm a Catholic. I'm a Christian. So I do not believe in rebirth and all that. From my religion point of view, I do not believe. But after doing all these studies and listening to all these experiences, I don't know. I will not say that. You know, as I told you in the beginning, I am ambivalent about this stuff. So we are somewhere, but I don't know where we are. Nobody knows. But I don't think death is the complete end of us.
Okay. Hi, sir. Sir, while investigating on any of the cases, have you yourself personally experienced any souls or spirits talking to you or telling you, ki, please don't write about us, and like just possessing, like kind of possessing you, ki, like.
So one soul and spirit that was constantly badgering me was Gurveen. She's my editor. So, but of course, a big support also from Gurveen. But actually, no. I did not face anything supernatural on the way of writing the story, because I don't think ghosts can understand that I'm writing about them. So, and ghosts are very local. I don't know. I will not talk about that, because there were so many things. Now, I'll be opening a can of worms, which I do not want to do. So no, it didn't happen with me, at least. One more, maybe?
Last one, please.
Yes, the planchette, yes. Yes. I have worked with it once. I have worked with a planchette once. That is the Ouija board. Once, when I was there, nothing happened. But I moved out, and people told me something happened. So I was not there to witness that. Yes.
So my question is, there are a combination of genres people write.
So are you planning to write like romance and horror together or something?
I have done that with Pishach. So Pishach is the story of two lovers and there is a ghost which is not allowing them to come together.
Good, thank you.
Okay, so thank you for a wonderful session here. Thank you, Gurveen.